Just a bit about Corem. I mean, just to put you a little bit into perspective, we're a geospatial systems integrator. We're based out of Quebec, Canada, but we also have offices in Denver and Albany in the United States. So we're a company that focuses on building enterprise geospatial applications for our customers, mostly internal, and deploying large projects. We have a team of about 70 employees working with us, and they range from statisticians to developers and this type of stuff. So we're not in the geospatial, traditional, or governmental type of organizations. We're more into the business GIS, so that's a different realm, or telecommunication being a very strong user of geospatial technologies. So are the insurance companies for underwriting claims purposes, as well as retail organizations, mostly to define sales territory, optimize customer, optimize revenue. So those are the three kind of verticals that we work with on a daily basis. So our approach is to take commercial off-the-shelf software with data. So this is where the FME comes in, you know, integrating data, integrating multiple sources of data into applications, and then we provide, you know, development hosting. So we provide the full 360 view of the project. So from inception to maintenance and support and hosting and all this stuff. So some few samples of the applications we build. So supply chain management, price monitoring, BI integration, which is a very, I don't know how much of you are familiar with the business intelligence world, but there's a lot of a big push right now to integrate geospatial capabilities as part of these projects, and we definitely want to believe that that's the case. So instead of being a map centric, it's map enabling, we'd call it. So we use the BI tools inside the BI tool to reach a broader level of users. So a little bit about specialty and expertise. So geocoding, data quality, a very important part of this whole ecosystem. Integrating data, translating data, transforming data is a very strong part, but data quality and validation is also a very important part. So we've developed that expertise, as well as enrichment, which is really what FME allows us to do. So we will talk to you about our project, and I will let Scott talk about that.
The totem pole gets the handheld. So the customer, AT&T Mobility, they were migrating from a existing BI tool. So they had actually another tool in there that they were happy with. It was doing stuff that they needed, but there was other issues that they needed to go into the future. There was maintenance issues, you know, some of the things we talked about today with the installing of server, et cetera. Some of that maintaining parts they had to have hurdles to come up. So they wanted to look at another tool. And they had over 200 users, and they had a very short time frame to do it. So when we talked about this other tool, we kind of compared the other tool with FME, and that you can see that they both actually win on certain points. FME is much better in the spatial side of things. The other tool ran a little bit quicker. FME is better at the automation. Just the nature of building it gives you the capabilities to automate it by exposing some of those parameters. So that was a good help for them there. Of course, FME, number of formats, et cetera, where it lives and breathes that stuff. But you can see the processing of non-spatial data, the other tool excelled there a bit. And the PDF side of things, the presentation output, it excelled. And some of these things that you see the other tool excelled at are probably concepts and some ideas that you've heard Dale and Don and others talk about, the non-spatial data, the PDFs. So obviously AT&T made its mark with FME guys. We had a in the equation of, we have the modules that you create with FME. They had 112 of those different processes that we had to translate. We had about 7 people working full time on this. It took approximately 6+ months to convert all this. Now, some of that was ramp up time. You know, at the very beginning, they didn't give us all their modules real nice. They waited till, like everybody does. We all hate change. You know, no one likes change. So there was resistance in that, and we had to reach out, and we had to prove over and over again that we could convert this stuff over, and it's not an undoable task. So as we got more people on board, you know, we got more and more modules, and of course, like the last month, we probably got half the modules. So, you know, talk about drinking from a fire hose, that's kind of what it was for this. So, but we got it all turned around for them. Just to give you an example, I pulled up some samples, and we talked about this idea of non-spatial. So at a FME conference, you know, probably 99% of people here are from a GIS, a geographic, a spatial background. Okay, so I jokingly thought to myself, this is my one time in life to be part of the one percenters. And that's the non-spatial. And it's true. I mean, these are huge companies, and it's never ceased to amaze me how these massive companies run their business, millions of dollars, on Excel and CSV. Because as GIS guys, many times we're the ones that are putting up these databases. We have access to it. So in FME, you're used to, hey, connect to the database, connect to the database. You can't here. They're getting just CSV and Excel dumps. So that big 6 gig of file that Dale mentioned, I believe it's pretty sure it came from this project. So it's a very, very non-spatial. Probably 80 to 90%, or actually more, of the modules we had to convert had no spatial side of it. And what's one of the kudos I'll absolutely give SAFE, I keep calling them FME, but they're SAFE, is their nimbleness to respond to the customer, respond to us, really engage and be a partner in the whole process. So if you guys might have seen, last year there was a lot of service packs, and some of the things that changed in there was the CSV readers, the Excel readers, those things. One of the items, the feature merger, when we first started this project, you know, when you're doing non-spatial data like that, you're going to have a lot of different joins because this is, you're dealing with IT. The reason they get these CSV and Excel dumps is because IT doesn't trust the business to connect to the database. We've had customers, not AT&T, others that say, you know, for them to get just as simple as we know it, a view that we can sit down and talk to a DBA, in probably an hour or two, he can get the information he needs to make that view. And we can get it, if we have access. But we have customers that says that takes 6 months and tens of thousands of dollars in internal cost to get that. So that's why we get these CSV dumps. So when you do that type of stuff, you have all these different joins. And one of the things you might have saw is how the feature merger started to be able to, you could join on multiple items in there, directly related from this project. So it's really opening up, I guess, SAFE's eyes in a sense, and they see this whole side of stuff that's non-spatial, where we do a lot of non-spatial stuff. In the GIS world, that's what we think. We've been spending 20 years to teach people what in the world we do. You know, I mean, my wife still doesn't know what I do, I think. And, you know, we use Google's great. Like, hey, it's Google. We do stuff like Google, okay? But the rest of the world actually, yes, we've been preaching and preaching and preaching spatial, but there's another side that we have to see that's non-spatial. And in enhancing that, bringing spatial in part of it, that's part of the question, but the whole question is really everything. Can we deal with all this data? And that's where this is kind of going. That's what this project, I guess, brought to SAFE. So, but there are some things that we did do that this previous tool, it thought in its own way. People were used to it. So in trying to make the conversion easier, we found very common basic concepts that they did over and over again, but they did it in their own special way. So of course we made various different custom transformers to help bridge that gap, to help the people not have to become brilliant users at FME. They are on the business side, they're non-technical, so we had to help bridge that gap for them quite a bit. So there were a number of projects or models in it that were on the simpler side, but there was quite a bit that got extremely complex throughout it. We had a process, you see this is the custom transformer they did for just the find nearest thing, as simple as find nearest, but the neighbor finder actually, it the way that they asked the question, the way that they were used to working with the tool, it actually bogged down quite a bit, so we had to find a different way around that. And FME was very good in engaging with us. We had bi-weekly calls for the whole 6 months, and it's actually still going on. It started where we got more complex, and walked them through almost like an extended training class, an extended deeper dive into the technology, into server, et cetera. But it has definitely benefited along the way as more people have heard about it, because everybody has to process stuff. People hate having to remember what did I click on and look at their flip page of all the different steps they've done. So it's a great thing about FME, right? It's like a programming tool. It's a rad development tool that saves your steps. So those guys have started to see that, so it's expanding into the business this way. And again, very much non-spatial, but as you can see, it did get kind of crazy at times whenever we had some very complex modules to figure out. Now this is not something like a lot of the other demos you've seen where we get into FME and actually do something, because we had no one question. We had 120 different questions we had to answer along the way. So only way I can really kind of explain that is there were some simple, some little complex, and then some real bad ones that we had to really work at to getting over the hurdle on that. So the customer was very happy. So as you can see, they are helping to give safe whole new ideas and new places that the tool can go to. So now it's back to JS.
No, I'm good. So point, it's funny, I was at a conference. Yeah, I do a lot of conference. I was at a conference 2 weeks ago, and the whole debate was, you know, spatial and everything. And spatial does not mean visualization. And that's a common misnomer. We always think of our world as having a map. And a lot of the time, just a point polygon is a lot of spatial for a lot of those companies, finding where you're serviced, where you're not serviced, are you near something. So spatial for these guys, although we're using FME and it has all these great spatial capabilities, sometimes it's the simplest features that end up being the most used. So a point polygon, a case in point. The other thing is as we said, they had over 200 users, and I think I'm kind of lowballing it. I think we're more in the 500 range at this point. And of 500 people, you're not going to get 500 people who are happy to change tools from a day, from today to tomorrow. And there's some resistance. There's a little, a holdout somewhere that they do not want to change. They're down to about 16 people now. So, but they're putting up a very, very serious fight. So I think we're going to live with this tool duality for a little while. And their reasons are very varied, but they always revolve around two special areas. So the first one is really around advanced reporting and maps. So FME has made great stride in the PDF creation, has made great stride in the mapping with MapNIC and so on. That being said, the other tool, because it's like a marriage, we're comparing this new wife with the old wife, and the other tool was a lot more efficient at, or simple, let's just say not efficient, or a lot more simpler to set up the outputs, right? You could just point and click and say, I want the legend, I want this, I want that, I want this report, and repeat over for every zip code in the US, and that was the output. So doing that in FME requires a lot more involved work, and we're collaborating with the SAFE folks on a daily basis just to understand where the product is going and where there's a gap. And I think for this customer, AT&T, we're going to kind of create an advanced reporting capability where they're going to have more of a simple point and click to get the remaining 16 happier and migrated over. The other piece is demographics analytics. So we've been hammering for the past 15 minutes that they did not use any spatial while we lied. They used a little bit. Mostly for demographics and analytics. So they use data from Experience and, Experian and what's the other company, Scott? AGS, to pull, good old statistics, census information, predictions and modeling, consumer spending. There's over 25,000 different variables that they look at different level of information. This is used by the marketing and sales group to go after a new customer or for network build out, If I offer this new 4 gigabit fiber line in this sector, what's the people looking like in that area, and I'm going to get the increased revenue I'm looking for. So demographic and analytics, I know the SAFE is looking into that. We're working with them, integrating that data, and then having the tools, the front-end tool, to be able to pull that easily. And FME server, that was the big clincher for SAFE, the FME server capabilities. The other tool did not do well on the server side of the business. So it was mostly desktop-based, and it is to be argued, to be honest, that having 200 users of a tool like FME or the other tool in a business doesn't necessarily make sense for most people, but they are AT&T and they're 100,000 employees, so in the scheme of thing, it makes a lot of sense. So that's why we're always a bit staggered with these numbers, but they're a huge company. So the FME server, which would eliminate a lot of these users desktop eventually, was is what is interested, but again they want it to be a little bit more customized, a little bit more to their fit for use. So we're gonna work with them and make it a lot easier to access and integrate. So I think one of the key reasons why we were in there is because we had the two partnerships. We've been working with SAFE for many years, and we've been working with the other one. I'll name them if you come and see me face to face, but for now I'll just stick like that. We've been working with both for many years, so we had that expertise. We know how to convert, we know what needed to be done, and we were able to objectively tell the customer, no, this is what you should expect, this is what you shouldn't expect. The enterprise expertise, deploying large applications, we had done that with them in other areas, so they were happy with that. We're integrating FME server into geospatial dashboards now in BI tool to streamline the data access and if we can get access to the database, as Scott said, and the ability to extend the product. So those were kind of the key clinchers for us in working with AT&T. So not too technical. I hope it satisfies you. I just want to give you a use case of a company who deployed so many licenses, and we'd be happy, me and Scott, to answer any questions that you may have at this point.
Thank you. Yes. So are there any questions for Scott and Jess? Yes.
Was there a single thing that was most difficult to replace with respect to the old software?
Certainly the PDF side of things, the prettiness side of stuff, right? That idea of getting PDFs with maps in them, and tables, and graphs, and that type of stuff is certainly probably been the biggest hurdle to overcome. And as JS said at the end, we're still working on it.
Other questions?
Yeah. JS just whispered to me, performance maybe. Yeah, the other tool, it's Screen, I gotta say. It's very fast. And it still is faster
in some areas.
Yeah. Spatial side of things, though, there is some spatial. 80-90% isn't, but there is absolutely, when they're spatial, it's AT&T, they're wireless. They got coverages that are massively detailed that you gotta deal with in there. Yeah, FME is the choice.
So the two tools really, if you compare them apples to apples, they don't overlap 100% whatsoever. There's probably like this. Fortunately, most of the features that we were trying to reproduce were in that overlap piece. And there's still advantages in using those in different contexts.
Other questions? I just had a question. I mean, you've obviously focused on AT&T as a big project. Is there other big ones lined up already with where you're thinking FME is going to be a good solution?
So on our end, that's in for conversion purposes only, but yes, on our end, we're seeing FME and FME server in our soup. I don't know if it's an English expression, but it's definitely a French expression. And so we're seeing it everywhere, and we feel there's a lot of projects that would benefit from that. We did a project 2 years ago involving Google Earth, not Enterprise, Google Earth, on the cloud, and we built an interface, and instead of writing KMLs, and just created a small error control, and we created a bunch of FME routines where we, it was for a smart grid. So I don't know if you're familiar with the smart grid concept, but it's basically the device in your home sending information back to the head office, and the daisy change, I can send it to this home, and it'll send it to the repeater, and so on. So it changes, it's a very, it's a network that changes on an hourly basis, essentially. So drawing it in a KML and exporting it was not